Grab your Bible. We're going back to St. Luke chapter 4. St. Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19. St. Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19. The word of the Lord reads, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and a recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed." Verse 19 says, "To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Somebody ought to say amen to the reading of God's word. This morning we are in part 3 of our I'm Anointed for This series. This morning, from the topic on this Father's Day, Daddy makes a difference. Daddy makes a difference. Father, we thank you for your word. The flower fades, the grass withers, but God, it is your word that stands the test of time. We pray now, God, that we will be able to lean in and listen in, God, and be able to receive everything that your word has for us. God, we ask you to rid us of every hindrance, every distraction, everything that tries to impede and stop the word of God from penetrating the airwaves and penetrating, most importantly, our hearts and our minds. We pray, God, that it will be removed right now in the name of Jesus. And God, I pray, God, that where we will be able to sit up on the edge of our seat and the edge of our hearts to receive your engrafted word, which is able to build us up, equip us, empower us, embedder us. We just simply need your word. At times like these, we need you to speak to us clearly as only you can. In Jesus' matchless name, amen, amen, amen. You can be seated in your home, in your office, wherever you are. Type that on the screen for me. Daddy makes a difference. Daddy makes a difference. Oftentimes on Father's Day, a lot of men, I've heard a lot of men kind of testify that their favorite thing to do isn't necessarily to go to the house of the Lord and to be able to hear a Father's Day message, because a lot of times it's just more so a beat down message talking about what men are not and what fathers are not and what we're not doing. But I think it's so important that where we ought to lift up our men, we ought to encourage our men, we ought to encourage our fathers. And as I've said 1,000 times, and I'll say it 1,001 now, if you have a half a man that is trying to be in his children's life, that are trying to work and trying to do and put out that energy and that effort, ladies, you ought to tell the Lord, thank you. If you got a half a man that's trying to be a father, regardless of what it is that you may have experienced as relates to a father or a daddy, you ought to honor. The Bible tells us we ought to honor our parents. We ought to honor our mothers and our fathers. We ought never to disrespect them. We ought never to bash them. But we ought to thank God for them, if I don't want my days to be cut short on the earth. And even if you're the father of your children, y'all relationship didn't work out and y'all went your separate ways, it should be to the point of that man, once again, is trying to be in the lives of his children and trying to be a father, trying to be a provider, you ought not to put up the barriers that oftentimes are put up that stops that father from being present in the lives of his children. Now, is that the case? Of course, it's not the case across the board, but that does happen. That does happen. And so we're not going to so much speak to the thing that is negative or the things that are so much trying to beat down the men today, but we will speak to the elephants in the room. We will deal with what's going on in society and what's going on as relates to what's happening in our world. Because if you know it or not, we're in the middle of some pandemics. I just mentioned one, COVID-19. We're still in the middle of a pandemic. So please, as my wife sent me a beautiful text yesterday, please put on your mask. Y'all got me in trouble posting a picture of me with somebody and they ain't had my mask on. So she said, "I'm covering you in prayer, man of God, as you're out there without your mask on." So I was like, "Oh Lord," that got me in trouble. But it's all good. So please continue to wear your mask and do all the things that you need to do. But then there's another pandemic that we're in the middle of right now. And this has our country torn up. This has us, it, as relates to our policies and our politics, have us split right down the middle. And because of all these things that has happened from Brother Lloyd and from Mr. Arbery and all these different individuals, countless individuals have happened, it has our nation really in turmoil and really have us in an unrest position. And on top of all of that, there's been another pandemic that's been going on for a long time. And it is the absence of our fathers, the absence of our fathers. I gave you the statistic last year that, did you know that there are one out of every four children live in a home without their father? One in every four children live in a home without their father. Now, if you don't think that that's a pandemic, if you don't think that that is something that we have to fight against, something that we need to speak to, then my friend, you probably are the problem. Even in our local church, I was looking at our worship team. There's no knock to our worship team and praise team. We use who we have. But even in our local church, they have multiple hundreds of people, not one male standing on the stage. Not one male, not one father standing on the stage leading our church into worship. And when the church, it's not that we got two of them, we got multiple hundreds of people, and yet not one male. And again, that's not a rebuke or that's not a shade to our worship team, because we use who we have, but it still speaks to the elephant in the room. If you don't know that there's a shortage of men, and there's a shortage of men of God even more than that, then my friend, as I've said, that you may be the problem. But I'm trying to be intentional. I'm trying to be very strategic to raise up some men of God, that where we'll be able to lead the people of God into worship, that where my wife don't got to come and grab my hand and say, baby, come on, let's pray, baby, come on, let's read, come on, let's study, baby. But no, I'm trying to raise up a group of men that's unashamedly worshiping God, and unashamedly wants to praise God, and unashamedly want to lift their hands, want to be broken in worship, want to cry. And don't say that all that praise and all that emotional stuff is for the women. But no, I'm trying to raise up a group of men of God that'll be like David, that'll dance and dance and dance, and doesn't matter who it is that's watching them, because they're not ashamed of who it is that God is. So that's what we need to know, and what we must understand, because daddies make a difference. Yes, they do. Daddies make a difference. There's something about seeing a man, and a lot of times people are trying to minimize, well, you the pastor, well, you the this, and you supposed to do that. No, I'm a child of God. Before I have any position in the kingdom, I'm a child of God. And before I ever was a pastor, before I was ever a senior or a pastor, come on here, I was worshiping God and praising God and doing what it is that we need to do. And we're looking for the men. Come on, TIL men. We're looking for the men, and most particularly, we're looking for the fathers that are able to stand up and do what needs to be done as relates to leading their home and leading us in worship, because that is make a difference. As I spoke to the pandemics that we're in right now, the thing that is being pushed, and the thing that we're really standing on, you hear this term, Black Lives Matter, Black Lives Matter, and I agree with that statement. I agree that Black Lives Matter, and you shouldn't be so quick to push back and say all lives matter. We know that all lives matter, but all lives are not in trouble right now. Come on, that's like you having a problem in your body, and then a person trying to bring attention or trying to help you with the problem that's in your body, and then somebody else standing on the side that's in perfect health, and they're saying, well, my stomach hurt too. Come on, we're not talking about you right now. We understand that you have an issue. We understand that you're there. You understand that you matter, but at the same time, that we have to make sure that we deal with the issue that is at hand. So that all lives matter narrative, we need to kind of put down the back burner for a second to be able to understand what it is that's going on. But even when it comes to us talking about Black Lives Matter, we have to really kind of grab and see what it is that we're doing and what we're trying to promote. Because as I am full, let me be clear, I am in 100% agreement with us pushing the agenda as relates to eradicating systemic racism in this country, eradicating all these different systems and structures that's put in place that has us down. But at the same time, while we are trying to fight for social justice, as we should speak up, we should protest, we should do all those things. While we're trying to do this, this particular movement, Black Lives Matter, is trying to take this moment and trying to push another agenda, trying to push another agenda. Before you grab a hashtag and before you just grab a shirt and before you just begin to just say what it is that you're pushing, you got to do a little research, and I'm sure that most of you have. Do a little research and dig into this organization that's pushing this agenda, because it's not just Black Lives Matter that they're pushing. They're trying to push the LGBTQ agenda as well. They're trying to push the feminist movement as well. And they're really trying to push. Come on, this is why I'm bringing this up. They're really trying to push the fathers out of their role and out of their position. Let me be clear one more time. I am for Black Lives Matter. Don't you sit up and say, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying I'm for the pushing of the eradicating of systemic racism in our country, the white supremacy in our country, and all those different things that go along with that. But I just want you to take a moment and just lean in and listen what this group represents and what they stand for. Just go to their website every now and then and go and start reading what we believe. And I know, I understand, I've used the hashtag before, Black Lives Matter, and because you use the hashtag, I don't mean you necessarily associating yourself with that particular people group or that particular movement, but you still need to know what it is that's out there. I took this exactly from their website. Listen to what it says from their website. Look what it says. It says, we disrupt the Western prescribed nuclear family structure requirement by supporting each other as extended families and villages that collectively care for one another, especially our children, to the degree that mothers, parents, and children are comfortable. Now, I just read that, and come on, you got to be, come on, I know I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer, but I'm in the drawer. You got to read this, and I know you've heard this, and you know this is Father's Day, and I know you saw a word that is strategically missed out of that particular sentence there. And this is on their website. Come on, don't look at it now. Come on, believe me, believe your boy, they'll look at it later. But can I tell you, just go look where they believe, and they are saying that they want to disrupt at the Western prescribed nuclear of the family. So here, this is a movement that's more than just trying to bring attention to police brutality. This is a movement that's more than just trying to bring to the forefront systemic racism. But no, this is a movement that's literally, in their own words, trying to disrupt and dismantle what the Western prescribed family structure is. What is the family structure? A husband and a wife. What is the family structure? A male and a female. What is the family structure? The way you have a parent and children. And this is not a Western structure. This is a biblical structure. This is what God created, and this is what God put in place. And so what am I telling you? It's not a matter of what we're trying to beat down the men and beat down the brothers, but no, it's a matter of us speaking to what it is that's going on and speaking to what's going on in our society, that where we can know what we ought to do. Oh, I'm so glad that I read in the book of Daniel that Daniel says that we ought to be like the people of God, that where those people that know their God, they'll be strong, they'll stand firm, and they'll do great exploits. Oh, I want to be like the sons of Issachar, that understand the times that we're in, and we'll know what we do and know what we ought to do. We ought to speak up for injustices. We ought to speak up for what it is that we stand for as a people. And it doesn't matter if it's an African American, doesn't matter if it's a Caucasian, doesn't matter if it's Japanese or Italian or German. Wherever there's injustice, if it's Latino, wherever the injustices are, the people of God ought to stand up. But I've seen some people that's more Democrat than they are Christian. Come on here. I've seen some folk that's more Black than they are Christian. And come on here, you can't lay down your Christianity to hold up your fist. But no, my friend, I can hold my fist up, and then I still can lift my hands up and give God some praise and give God some worship. It's not an either or. No, my friend, I am to know that what's going on. So people of God, what am I trying to tell you? We're living in a world, we're living in a society that's trying to subtly, trying to sneak in and dismantle
who it is that we are, who we're supposed to be. And we got to be very, very careful that we're not promoting and we're not pushing an agenda and even sowing into or funding an agenda that's trying to tear down what it is that we stand for as the people of God. Oh, can I tell you that fathers matter? Can I tell you that daddies matter? Can I tell you that we being in prison, us being where it is that we need to be, and being in our home and being there for our children, it makes all the difference in the world. Somebody will say amen to that right there. Fathers and daddies matter. They help us with our self-esteem and our self-confidence. You see, oftentimes persons who don't know who they are as relates to their self-esteem and their confidence, because they didn't have that father, didn't have that man speaking into their life and telling them that they're beautiful, telling them that they're handsome, telling them that they are cut above, telling them that they're not second best. It helps us in that area. It helps us with our sexuality, our masculinity as men, and our personal identity. Can I tell you that daddies matter? Because there's a young girl somewhere that's looking and longing for the love of her father. And because she never got that love and that affirmation from her father, she's looking for it in all the wrong places. And anybody that'll wink at her, anybody that'll blow in her ear and whisper sweet nothings in her ear, now she'll try to gravitate to that love that she should have got from her father. Can I tell you that daddies matter? Can I tell you that daddies matter when it comes to how I deal with my marriage when I grow up? How do I deal with my wife if I saw my daddy putting his hands on my mama to shut her up and for her to be quiet? Then that's what it is that I'm going to push that forth. That's what I'm going to be. If I saw my daddy being absent, if I saw my daddy just working and working and working and working and saying, oh, shut up and go ask your mama, leave me alone, then that's what I saw, then that's what I'm going to push. Can I tell you that daddies matter in every area of your life? I'm just trying to tell you that your daddy matter. And if you dismiss that, if you debunk that, and you think that that's not important, then my friend, you might got some daddy issues. If you don't think that that is important, if you don't think that fathers matter and daddies matter, then my friend, you are part of the problem. That's why I believe that Jesus got me in this series, because no matter what it is that we're going through, and I take this personally, no matter what we're going through as a nation, no matter what we're going through as a community, no matter what's going on with this pandemic health-wise, can I tell you that God is reminding all of this, that all of us, that we are anointed for this. We are anointed for this. I don't know why in the world a person would want to be a pastor. I just don't know why they would want to be. Can I tell you that for the serious pastors and the real pastors, it's not easy getting up here every week and speaking to individuals about things. It's not easy diving into the Word of God, as I was explaining to my wife last night. Now, there's a lot of things I teach about. There's a lot of things I preach about that I missed the mark on. But just because I missed the mark, that don't mean I'm just going to skip over it. Come on here. If I preach about prayer, I need to amp it up a little bit in prayer. If I preach on giving, I got to amp it up a little bit in giving. I'm talking about me being the pastor, being the leader, being the one that's giving out the Word of God. If I'm preaching on forgiveness, I need to amp it up. But there's not another subject that I feel more inadequate in. There's not another subject as relates to being a father, as relates to being a dad. And when I sit down and think about the weight and the gravity of the fact that I got four individuals that's hanging on my every word, that I got four individuals that's watching my every move, I got four individuals that watch everything I do, three daughters, one boy, and I'm telling you that brings some pressure to me, because I'm saying, man, they watching me. The way I deal with my wife, they watching me. The way I interact with them, they're watching me. I got to teach them and train them. That's a lot of pressure. And you just think you just want to get up and just to be able to give a nice little Father's Day message. No, this is not what this is about. Because when you're serious about the things of God, you're saying, God, help me. Help your boy out. God, I'm not a deadbeat, but God, I have not apprehended what it is that I need to apprehend. And so what am I saying? I'm saying to all of us, no matter what message this is, no matter what word we're preaching about and teaching about, you need to be able to grab the Word of God and say, man, I can do better. Come on here, y'all, to type down the screen, I can do better. Come on, you can be a better daddy. You can be a better husband. You can be a better mother. You can be a better wife. You can be a better child. You can be a better member of Truth and Love. Come on, you can be better. Come on, I can be better. You can be better. I'm anointed. I'm anointed for this.
I'm anointed this for this. That's why Jesus said in Luke 4:18, he said, the Spirit, come on, we've been teaching this for the last several weeks. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's anointed me to preach the good news, to proclaim the good news to the poor. Here it is. This is the part we've already preached about. He's anointed us to preach the gospel to the poor. Oh, last week we dealt with he's anointed us to preach to the brokenhearted, the wounded healer. And now we want to deal with today. I'm going to grab two of them and put them together. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives. And also, I'm going to skip over the recovering sight of the blind. We'll deal with that next week, Lord's willing. And to set at liberty those who are oppressed. I believe there's a group of people that's listening to me right now. Oh, that are captive because of their daddy issues. I believe that there is a group of people that's listening to me right now, regardless of the fact if you are the father or if you have not been fathered. Can I tell you that there's a group of people that are captive and that are oppressed because of what's going on in their lives? And I found the passage of scripture that we're going to marry with this Luke 4:18, and we're going to marry this particular narrative of what's going on in the life of this father and his son, and we're going to get some people set free. We're going to get some people that are oppressed liberated. We're going to get some people, because can I tell you that Jesus said, he whom the Son have set free, we're free. We're free. We're free indeed. This particular story, you'll find it. You find it in Matthew. You find it in Mark. You find it in Luke. So we're just going to kind of cherry pick through the three narratives in the gospel, not in a traditional way, but we're going to pull them together as the Holy Spirit is guiding me. And we're going to be able to see what it is that we can do and find out how daddies really matter. The text tells us that Jesus was on the mountain of transfiguration. As he was on the mountain of transfiguration, the Bible says that Moses and Elijah showed up. And that what was on the inside of Christ is shown on the outside. That what was on the inside of him, he was God in the flesh. And that what was going on the inside, it was shown on the outside. Can I tell you that Peter, James, and John were up there on the mountain with Jesus. And Peter had the bright idea. He said, Lord, it's good for us to be here. He said, let us build three. Come on, if you're from Jacksonville, he'll say three tabernacles. Come on. He said, let us build three tabernacles and let's stay here. But Jesus said, no, we can't stay here, but no, we got to go. But then I heard a voice come out from the cloud and say, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. I love that, because said the father affirmed his son. I love that. That's not even my text. That's not even what I'm going through, but I'm just trying to set the context. They're on the mountain of transfiguration and they've seen the glory. They've seen the splendor. And then they come down off the mountain of transfiguration. And this is where we pick up our story. Look at it, Luke chapter 9, verse 37. It says, on the next day when they had come down from the mountain, a great crowd met them. Now they were on the mountain. God was showing them things. God was illuminating. As I've said, God showed what was on the inside of Christ was illuminated on the outside. They were on the mountaintop, and then when they came down the mountain after that glorious experience, here they run into a great crowd. Mark kind of expounds on what was going on. Look at Mark 9:14. It says, and the scribes arguing with them. Here Jesus was on the mountain of transfiguration. They've come down. He was with Peter, James, and John. So there was 12 disciples. So that means there was 9 left. Come on, there was 9 left. And the 9 disciples were there arguing with the scribes. They were arguing with them. Look what Jesus said in verse 16. Jesus asked the scribes, what are you arguing about with them? What's the problem? Isn't that amazing how you can have a mountaintop moment, and then when you come back down in the valley, here go some mess. Can I tell you? That's exactly what goes on. Come on, you can be logged on right now on the YouTube, on Facebook, on Twitter, on the website, and you can enjoy the worship. You crying, Abba, you crying. Come on, you get the word of the Lord. You all empowered, you encouraged, you equipped, and all that. And soon as this service is over, or even in the middle of it, somebody better turn that down. What you doing? You ain't in no church. What's wrong with you? As soon, come on, y'all, go talk to me here. Come on, do you remember?
Do you remember we said come to the house of the Lord, and when we in here dancing and shouting and enjoying Jesus, hallelujah, and then you leave right out of here and run right back into the devil, run right back into Satan, and somebody try to snatch out of you exactly what it is that God just put on the inside of you? You must be warned. You must be warned. You got to warn. Yeah, I'm trying to warn you and let you know, whenever you have a mountaintop moment, you can always look for the valley to be treacherous. You can always look for the devil. Anytime God get the shifting, you can look for the devil to get the sifting. Yes, sir. Anytime God get the moving, you can look for the enemy of our soul to do whatever he can to try to pull this thing down. And so Jesus on the mountain, he comes back down, and it was the scribes. It was the scribes that were arguing with the disciples. Come on, watch it very closely. It was not the disciples arguing with the scribes. It was the scribes arguing with the disciples. It was not the disciples arguing with the world. It was the world arguing with the church. Oh, can I tell you that that's exactly what's going on? Because we're looking at everything that's happening, and we feel like because we ingest it, we feel like because we going through what we going through, we feel like we got to argue with everybody. We feel like we got to say everything. Come on, y'all ain't gonna talk to me. Y'all didn't see that left foot coming, but I intentionally went the long way around so I could be able to give it to you right there. Can I tell you, we have no business as being the people of God arguing with the world. We have no business as the people of God. Sure, we should speak up. Sure, we should speak the truth to power. Sure, we should speak the truth in love. Sure, we ought to say what we need to say. But it should never be said about the people of God that I'm acting like the world. It should never be said to the people of God that I'm cussing so you can know how mad I really am. It should never be said about the people of God that I'm going to lay down my religion for a minute that I can give you a piece of my mind. Boo-boo, you need all the mind you got. Come on here. You don't got enough mind to be giving. You can't afford to give nobody a piece of your mind. You need them all. You don't even know where your glasses at, and they sitting on top of your head. Look. Time I give somebody a piece of your mind. You walked into a room, didn't know why you was there. Walked out, remember what you was there for, then went back in, and then you forgot again. And you trying to get somebody a piece of your mind? Y'all ain't gonna talk to me. That's for everybody on. Look what my sister said. My sister Lisa Fields. I love this. I saw this last week, and it just blessed me. And I've been trying to get it in my spirit. I'm gonna give her this credit here, so I don't have to give her no more credit moving forward, because I'm stealing this. Here, can I tell you? That's what preachers do. Anyway, look what she says. Every controversy doesn't need your commentary. Y'all not gonna help me here. I said every controversy, thank you, Lisa Fields, doesn't need your commentary. Jesus on the mountain comes down off the mountain, and here the world is arguing with the church. The world is arguing with the disciples, but we must be very careful. Can I talk to TIL Nation? Can I talk to the people that I lead, the people that I'm responsible for? Just because it's a controversy, that doesn't mean you got to speak to it. Just because it's a you got to jump on everything. You got to show your disgust and your anger and your disdain with everything. Come on here, my friend. Sometimes we push more hate than we push love. Sometimes we push more division than we push love. Sometimes we'll get on here. I saw it earlier. We'll talk about a leader. We'll talk about a well-known, well-renowned pastor in the city, and we just to be talking about it and be dismantling, be talking about, and don't know we're divisive. Don't know that we're being used by the enemy the way we should not. We're the people of God. Why in the world are we tearing down one another? Why in the world are we talking about what this person is saying, what this person not doing, who this person with, who this person is not with? It should not be named among the people of God. Y'all can look at me like that all you want to. I know what I'm saying is right. If you try to change the station, the Lord gonna shut your Wi-Fi down. You better get this word right here. Come on, you can try to watch a Netflix movie all you want to. Your Netflix account, I'm gonna call it down, because it's coming down in the name. Maybe pray against your Netflix account. I pray against it. Hulu too, all that. Look what the Bible says. It may not still be in your Bible, but it's still in mine. Look what it says, James 1:19. It says, Amplified, understand this. Look what James said. Understand this, my beloved brethren. Let every man be quick to speak. No. Anybody see it on the screen? It's about right here somewhere. He said, let every man be quick to speak their mind. Let every man be quick to hear. Look, a ready listener. Slow to speak, slow to take offense, and to get angry. That verse of scripture doesn't fit our current context. Because as believers, even as persons in the house of God, we are quick to hear, but we're really not listening.
Have you ever been talking to someone and communicating with someone and you're trying to get your point across and you know they're not paying you no attention whatsoever? They're trying to wait for you to be quiet so they can counter what you've said. And you're saying to them, you're not even listening to what I'm saying. You're not even hearing what it is I'm trying to tell you. Come on, people of God, we ought to be quick to hear and slow. I'm not saying we can't speak. I'm just, the Bible says we ought to be slow to speak and slow to get offended. My God, I ain't never seen so many toilet tissue, one ply, dollar general, toilet tissue feeling people. Come on here, somebody. You was a baby because I'm a thug all day, every day. Come on, you was a thug, but now you come to the house of the Lord. Come on here, now you so Susie sensitive. Now you know Samuel sensitive. Come on here, you so sensitive about every little thing. Come on here, on Father's Day. Can I say this on Father's Day? Man up. Come on here. Can I say that every, y'all ain't said nothing. Can I tell you that comes a point and a time as a people of God that where we can't be so easily offended by every little thing. How can something that you're doing offends me so badly to the point that I'm trying to tear your character down? Did you just hear what I said? How can you be doing something so egregious, so flagrant that it offends me so the way I got to tell everybody about it? That hit you Tuesday. Look, let me tell you, look, the Jesus had to come down and Jesus said, what are y'all arguing about? He said to the scribes, and he's talking to his disciples, and I noticed that even in this situation, it was something that had jumped off. It was something that was going on that had the world fussing at the church and had them in this argument. And can I tell you the same thing that's going on now? It's a demonic influence. It's a demonic influence. It was a demonic influence. Here, this is the issue that's going on. Let's pick up the issue and let's move forward. Look, it says Mark 9:17 says, who is possessed by a spirit and has robbed him of his speech? So this is what was going on here. Here Jesus comes down the mountain, and here they're in the middle of this argument. And here it was this father that had brought his son. He had brought his son to the disciples, and he had this demon. He had this demonic influence, and the Bible says he was possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of his speech. This is what the issue is. It's a demonic influence, and here every time I jump on every issue. Come on here. You've seen this in marriage. You've seen this that where if your spouse is always complaining about everything, whenever it is, it's a real issue. You're not going to be able to hear what they're saying because they complain about everything. And can I tell you that look at the text. The text says this was a brother that was possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of his speech. Can I encourage somebody right now not to lose your voice, not to allow the devil to rob you of your speech, not to allow the devil to rob you of your commentary, not for you to cry wolf so much that when the wolf really shows up, nobody moves because you've been talking so much. Oh, come on here, my friend. The Bible said this brother was possessed. There was a demonic influence. This brother was possessed and he lost his voice. The enemy had robbed him of his speech. And there was some things because this brother was demon possessed, because his son, this child, was controlled by the devil. There's three things that went on in his life. The first thing is this: we see seized. This brother was seized. He was controlled by this devil, by this demon, and he was seized. He was seized. Look at Mark 9:18. It says, and wherever it lays hold on him, what would the devil seizes him? Look at this, so as to make him its own. Look what the text says. The text says this son, this father, happy Father's Day, this father brings his son to Jesus, and he's explaining what's going on in the life of a child. He says that the devil has seized him. The devil has seized him so he can make him its own. And this is what's so important. This is so powerful, because here this is what we're up against as the people of God. This is the role of fathers. This is the role of being men of God, that where we will understand that the devil is trying to seize our children. What is seize? Seize is to get hold of something by laying hands or grasping something, whether it's directly or indirectly, to grab. It means to dominate. It means to grab it forcibly, and that's what the enemy is doing, even in our society. But let me go further. Not only do we see him being seized, we see something secondarily. We see self-inflicted pain. This is the attributes. This child is demon possessed. We see some demonic influence here, And the Bible says he sees, and we also see some self-inflicted pain. Look at 9:18 again, Mark 9:18. And look what the Spirit does. It throws him down. It throws him down. It literally means to cause one to fall on the ground into convulsion. This Spirit is throwing him down, trying to cause some self-inflicted pain. Look at what happened in the life of this child. Now, this child was blessed to have his father there, because his father is the one that brought him to Jesus. But can I tell you that I see a principle. Somebody say that, a principle. I see a principle of a child who does not have a father, that when the devil tries to seize him and the devil tries to throw them down, try to cause some self-inflicted pain. That's somebody listening to me right now. I guarantee you. Maybe somebody even in this room that is battling some thoughts, some suicidal thoughts, that what the enemy is telling you that it's better for you not to be here, that the enemy is telling you they don't love you, they don't care about you, and the enemy will tell you that persons don't care about you. It's a lying spirit. I heard one of the worshipers say that there is no truth in the devil, and anything the devil tells you, it is a lie, because he's the father of a lie. So if the devil is telling you anything, you ought to believe the opposite of that thing. Oh, there's some persons that where you've been hearing this lying spirit that your family don't care about you. It'd be better for you not to be here, because your children don't affirm you, your children don't receive you, your children don't love you. And there's a lying spirit, and then there's something called the spirit of heaviness, the way the enemy tries to come and couple. That's a detonating combination right there. A lying spirit and a spirit of heaviness coming together, something getting ready to blow up. Oh, because when you feeling all down and mopey and droopy, and you can't put one foot in front of the other, where it feel like people don't care, come on, you can't pick yourself up, come on, you always see the glass halfway empty, the cloud is always gloomy. Come on here, that's a lying spirit, and it's a spirit of heaviness. Oh, but the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he have anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to set them at liberty, though that the enemy is peddling and pushing them a lie. Oh, come on, you can't believe the lie of the devil. You cannot believe the lie of the enemy. You got to know what God is saying. You got to speak what God is saying. You got to receive what God is saying. You got to know who you are, because the word of God have told you there's a lying spirit. His brother being thrown down. It's a deadly combination. And the Bible says that his brother, not only was his brother seized, not only was his brother had some self-inflicted wounds, but now look at Mark 9:18 again. I'm just going to look at these verses of scripture. Y'all all right, right? Yes, Father's Day. Come on. Now Mark 9:18, look what it says again. And he foams at the mouth, good God, and grinds his teeth. This brother is foaming at the mouth and grinding his teeth. I'm going to skip all of that. Can I get to the end of the matter and just tell you exactly what the devil is trying to do? Let me tell you exactly what the devil's trying to do. All of these things that we're seeing in John is right here in John 10:10. The thief comes only to steal, to kill, and to destroy. He'll use whatever it is he can, whether it's COVID-19, whether it's racial tension, whether it's father's absence. He'll use whatever he can just to steal, just to kill, and to destroy. But look at this third thing in his brother's life. Oh, my friend, I see it so plain in so many lives of people who have not dealt with their father issues. It's called stagnation. We see a seizing. He's controlled by this enemy. He's controlled by the devil. And if you're not a child of God, the Bible tells us, Romans 8:8. I know y'all don't like this kind of commentary, but that's why you go to truth and love, so I can tell you the truth in love. Anyone, we are not all God's children. We're not all God's children. I can't do that, ladies. He told me to stop doing that. We are not all God's children. We are not all God's children. The Bible says in Romans 8, he said, if you don't have the Spirit of God, you are none of his. Come on here. You may be God's creation, but if you don't receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and your personal Savior, that is not the pappy. I wish Maury was here. But Maury will tell you are his, not the Father. Yes, sir. Can I tell you that if you are not a child of God, You're not God's child. This means you're not a child of God. You're not saved. You're not his child. And here we see this so often in so many people's lives. Not only the seizing, not only self-inflicted pain, but also look at it, the stagnation. Look at it in Mark 9:18. I'm not making it up. Stop making it up. Y'all just log off in church hop. Go to another church you've been trying to look at anyway. Look at Mark 9:18. Look what it says. And he does what? He falls into, look at this, a motionless stupor. And is wasting away. Does that describe somebody you know? Does that describe maybe a season in your life? Maybe you've been in a motionless stupor, stagnation, the way you just can't get it together, where you just feel yourself deteriorating, you feel yourself wasting away. And one trans, I love the English Standard Version, says he becomes rigid. He's just describing to Jesus what's going on in the life of his child. To become rigid is to stiffen. To become rigid is to dry up. To become rigid, it just simply means to lose all of your vigor, all of your fire, all of your flow. And here, this is the condition of this boy. And I believe this is the condition of so many of the individuals, because we have, good God, because we have allowed the enemy some influence in our lives. And we've been seized. We've been self-inflicted. We've experienced stagnation. And then I see it go further. Somebody say, go further, go further, go further. I see it goes further, because now I see not only this demonic influence, I see a display of symptoms. Ooh, boy, you preaching. A display of symptoms. You'll see it. You'll see it because it's so good. Because two of the gospel writers define it as one thing. And Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they define it as one thing. But Matthew defines it as something else. Look at the Matthew 17:15. Look how it's defined. He has epilepsy. And is suffering very much. look at how the writer defines it. Matthew defines this. He said this is epilepsy. So let me be clear. Let me be clear up front. A person who has this condition, every person that has this condition, does not mean that they're demon possessed. A person can have this condition and not be demon possessed, but a person can have this condition and be demon possessed. Come on, there's a lot of things. There's a lot of things that where we can see on the outside. There's a lot of things we can see on the exterior. Oh, that has something much more to do with not so much of what we see on the outside, but it's something going on the inside. That's why I said this is some symptoms, because you cough. That the cough is not what's wrong. It's something on the inside. Because you sneeze. The sneeze is not the illness. The sneeze is not the issue. No, that's a symptom of the issue. Oh, look what Matthew said in Matthew 17:15. It says, look what the father said, Lord, have mercy on my son. Look what he goes further. He says, for he is a lunatic. He's a lunatic. He's sore vexed, for oft times he falleth in fire, and oftentimes this fire is trying to destroy. Look what the enemy is trying to do. The enemy is trying to destroy him. The enemy is trying to kill this brother. And what is pastor trying to tell you? That where you can see a person outwardly acting a particular way, and because you see them outwardly acting a particular way, that's not the issue. It's something else a little further. You're seeing the fruit, but you got to get to the root. Come on, I've told y'all, if I walk into the house and if I say something that's just really simple, if I say something that's just a joke to me, y'all know I'm a joke, so just a joke to me, and then Lady C go from 0 to 1,000. Come on here, can I tell you, it wasn't what I just said. It was something else. Come on here. It was something that I didn't say. It was something that I didn't do. Oh, come on. And I'm the same way. Have you ever been talking to somebody and you're trying to talk to me, like everything good? You're like, hey. You're like, oh, okay. What's wrong with you? Oh, y'all ain't gonna talk to me. Can I tell you that there are some things that are down on the inside, and I'm talking to some people. Come on, hear me, y'all. Y'all stick with me on this, because there are some people that are displaying symptoms, but the root of their problem is their daddy problems. Let's see if we can't unearth it. I'm finna skip a lot. Y'all just keep up with me back there in the screen, Mr. Screen people. Just keep up with me. Look at some symptoms. A friend of yours might be dealing with daddy issues. Trust issues. It's really hard, difficult for your friend to trust people. Maybe dealing with some daddy issues. A need for constant reassurance and validation. You got to tell them every other word. I love you. I'm with you. I got you. Maybe your friend dealing with daddy issue. Jealousy issues. Not old jealousy type of thing. Like, you know, I'm looking at my old lady. I'm talking about the jealous kind of like I put their hand on your car. Kind of just see. No, you've been home all. Your car too warm for you. You've been home for 2 hours. And I'm talking the kind that call and be like, you know, I'm on my way home, baby. He's like, you should have been here 30 minutes ago. That light around the corner from the house only hold you for 30 seconds, and then the wind is only blowing at 30 degree rate. And so if you were driving at speed limit of 55 miles an hour, and you should have been here 15 minutes ago. Fear of abandonment, because person has left you, daddy left you, daddy wasn't there. And now you feel like anybody or somebody or anyone who tells you they love you or any man in your life or male in your life, you feel like they're going to abandon you. That's not for you. That's for a friend. Constant struggles with authority figures. When a person doesn't have that father, that affirming voice, that disciplinarian, that person that say, no, sit down, no, be quiet, no, I said be home at this time. And when you don't have that, and then when you're released into the real world, every person that is an authority figure, be it a boss, be it a pastor, be it any type of person of authority, there's a challenge there. When I start making stuff up, y'all just going to church hop. But now, look, let me tell you what else. Poor communication skills. Because you don't know how to express yourself. You don't know how to say what you need to say because you haven't had that opportunity. But can I tell you that your friend may be dealing with some daddy issues. But can I tell you, I'm so glad that no matter the demonic influence, no matter the display of the symptoms, no matter the symptoms you may be displaying, and here I'm glad that you're leaning in. I'm glad that you listen. I'm glad that you can hear these different things. And these are several things that I could have put in. I could have crammed hundreds of symptoms and hundreds of things in this particular message. But I'm just trying to show you that maybe what it is that you're lashing out, maybe the way that you're flaring up, maybe the thing that you're dealing with isn't that. Maybe it's something else on the inside. But I'm glad, no matter the demonic influence, no matter the display of symptoms, I'm glad that there is a deliberate father. Good God. I'm glad that there's a deliberate father. I'm glad that this father was deliberate, because Jesus asked the question, what are y'all arguing about? The scribes didn't speak up. The Pharisees didn't speak up. Oh, but there was a deliberate father that spoke up. There's a deliberate father that was consciously. Come on, if you're going to be a good father, you got to do it consciously. If you're going to be a good father, you got to do it intentionally. You got to do it with intentionality. You got to be considered. You can't be impulsive. You got to can't do it in a hurry. Wait, you got to be deliberate if you're trying to be a good father. I love this father. Look what he says in Mark 9:17. It says, and someone from the crowd answered him, teacher, I brought my son to you. Oh, can I tell you that this was a deliberate father. He brought his child to Jesus. And a real father doesn't stay in the crowd. A real father differentiates himself from the crowd. A real father just don't stay in the crowd because everybody else trying to dodge child support. A real father step out the crowd because everybody else say they got a crazy baby mama. Oh, she wasn't that crazy. Come on here. You were doing something with her. It was somebody you like. Come on here, somebody. Or a real father just don't try to shuck and duck and dodge every responsibility. Oh, but a real deliberate father, they'll stand up, they'll step up, they'll be present, they'll do what they need to do. Come on here, somebody. A deliberate father just won't play into the narrative of the world, but the deliberate father say, I don't care what everybody else doing. I'm here for my baby. Look at the deliberation of this father. Look how deliberate he was. Matthew 17:14 says, and a man came up to him and kneeled before him. Oh, a deliberate father is a humble father. A deliberate father is a father that's a worshiper. A real father and a deliberate father is one that will step out. I don't care if I'm the only man with my hand lifted up. I'm going to worship him. I'm going to praise him. I'm going to lift him up. I'm going to magnify him. I'm going to extol him. That's what a deliberate father. Look what else he says in Matthew 17:15. It said, the man said, Lord, have mercy on my son. Oh, that's what a deliberate father is, a praying father. A deliberate father step out from the crowd. A deliberate father step up to the plate, and a deliberate father step into the presence of God. A deliberate father come into the presence of Jesus and say, Lord, I need your help. Lord, I need you to touch my mind. I need you to touch my marriage, touch my money, and touch my baby. That's a deliberate father. I love this. Look what his brother says. Look what he says in Luke 9. I told you we're going to use them all. Luke 9:38. Look what his brother says. Look at how deliberate he is. Come on, fathers. I want you to lean in on this. He said, teacher, I beg you, look at my son. All he said was, look at him. Y'all don't know how good that is. He said, look at how deliberate he is. He says, Father, he said, Jesus, Master, Teacher, look at my son. That's how deliberate a father needs to be whenever there's something going on in your child's life that where you know, you sense there's some demonic influence. Come on, you sense there's something in the milk not clean. As one of our sisters say, something in the milk ain't right. Can I tell you that you sense that something is going on? You got to say, Lord, look at my son. When was the last time you asked the Lord to look on your family? You're talking about them. You're on the telephone telling everybody about what's happening. When was the last time you said, Lord, look at my condition? Let me tell you about how deliberate father. Well, let me show you the fruit of a deliberate father. I need to be deliberately involved in verbally instructing my children or his children. A deliberate father, deliberately involved in verbally instructing his children. I'm not leaving everything up for my wife to do. I'm not sitting back while my children run my wife crazy and I don't say anything. I'm of the persuasion. I'm of the belief that one day y'all gonna be married. Y'all gonna be out the house, and y'all not gonna be. Can I stay at Northside? Y'all ain't gonna be studying us. And now why you finna run my wife crazy when you gone? And I got to deal with a crazy. Y'all ain't gonna talk to me. No, I'm gonna stay. You're not finna make my wife cry. You're not finna have her frustrated. I said, sit your little. I'm gonna do like my mama when she closed her eyes and son. Dude, you know you're a messed up. She said, sit your little narrow behind down. So y'all ain't gonna talk. Y'all, where the mama's at? And that's what used to get me in trouble, because she used to do it so much, and I was so gangster. She closed her eyes and do like this, and I just move out the way. Come on here. When she opened up her eyes, she do like this, and either two things happen. Either she laugh or I get tore up. Come on here, somebody. Two things don't happen, but it was worth it all. My mama says, sit your little narrow, huh? Come on, deliberate father is intentionally involved. It's smelling like a little quan. Nobody mama talk like that, huh? Mama says, I didn't know what a quan was. She said, I'm smelling. I was like, hit the quan, mama. She said, no, you smell like a quan. Anyway, I had to deliberately be involved in instructing my children. Have you set your children down to tell them about sexuality? I've been telling my little girl since they could talk, I'm the only man love you. Even when he tell you he love you, he don't love you, he love it. Y'all don't talk like that to your children, I guess. Come on, y'all can censor me all you want, but can I tell you, you got to tell him what's going on. Tell him he don't lie. I don't care what he say. You got a deliberate father deliberately leads them in the family devotions and prayer. A deliberate father is deliberate in praying with his children. And this is one of the things I'm like, oh boy, I got to do better with this. When the children were in school, I hadn't gotten to a real good habit, real good thing where I was laying my hands on them and praying with them every day. But since all this rona hit, when them jokers sleep, I want them to stay asleep. Y'all ain't going to talk to them. I just throw a prayer at them. Anybody ever throw a prayer? Don't wake them up. Let's throw a prayer at them. I'm waking them jokers up, but I got to do better. I got to speak in my children. I got to pray. They got to know I'm praying. I pray over them. I lay my hands. I do all that. But the intention that I got to be more deliberate as a father. Now, I'm saying this, and I'm the pastor. I'm just going to let that go. Deliberately monitoring what's entering into their impressionable minds. You don't never snatch their phone. You don't never go into their history. You'll never go through their text messages. You'll never look at all the apps to see if they real apps. You don't do a little quick Google. What apps are kids using to hide stuff? Y'all don't know about that. Okay, all right. Even deliberate. Hey, you got to be deliberate on what's going on in their impressionable mind, because they're being formed and shaped, whether you're intentionally doing it. Or unintentionally do it, or unintentionally do it, or whatever word it is, you're not doing it on an intention. Can I tell you that? I got my teacher right here. She's like, can I tell you that? You have to be deliberate. Here it is. Let me get out of here. Deliberately being an example. Have the deliberate. I can't let my hair down, because I got my children watching me. I'm not saying to be phony. I'm not saying be fake. I'm not saying be superficial. You let them in your world the way they can understand that life is not just a handout, but life is difficult and life is hard. But I cannot just model and exemplify hate and foolishness and all this stuff, because I am an example. Let me ask you this question. I've asked you before, brothers, father. Come on, ask you again. Are my children more Christ-like because of me? Or are they more Christ-like in spite of me?
Are they more like Jesus because of me? Or are they more like Jesus in spite of me?
That speaks to some real intentionality. And here, I'm closing this thing out. Let me tell you, because this is where it needs to be said of every man, needs to be said of every father. There needs to be a point to where my children ought to be able to look at me and point to me and be able to say, that's my father, that's my daddy. Is he perfect? Absolutely not. Do he have flaws? Yes, he does. Do he have shortcomings? Yes, he does. But the psalmist tells me in Psalm 37:37, it says, mark the perfect man. That's not talking perfect without flaw. That's talking about perfect as relates to a mature, a developing man. It said, mark the mature, the developing man, and behold the upright. And to end, he said, for the end of that man is peace. Come on, I'm trying to man somebody up today. I'm trying to father somebody up today, that where somebody can mark you. Somebody can say, there lies a man that loves his family. There lies a man that loves his children. You got to be able to be marked. Look, let me get out of here. This is my last thing here. We see the demonic influence. We see the display of symptoms. We see the deliberate father. But also we got to see this development in doubt. That development even in doubt. Even when I had seasons of my life the way I wish I could forget about. But yet still, I still need to be developing. I still need to be growing. I still need to be striving. I still need to become everything that God desires for me to come. Look at this brother. Even his development in this conversation with Jesus. Mark 9:21 said, then Jesus asked the father, how long has it been going on? How long has this been happening? He said, from a childhood. Verse 22, look what the brother says to Jesus. Look what he says to Jesus. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Look at the development of this father. Look at the development of this brother. Look at this brother development even in doubt. He said, if you can, help us. What do you mean? Jesus has been on the mountain. He came down from the mountain. And the Bible said there was a great crowd. You think the great crowd was just there just because they want to hang with Jesus? No, they have seen his miracles, his signs, his wonders. Some have heard his teaching, his preaching, the word of God. They're there for a reason. Look at Jesus' response in verse 23, New Living. It says, what do you mean if I can? Jesus asked, anything is possible if a person believes. Oh, come on. I'm speaking to that father that made some bad decisions. I'm speaking to that father that have made some mistakes in the way you're saying, well, I don't know. I wasted so much time. I wasted so much money. I wasn't there for them when they were young. I didn't pay for them to go to the prom. I wasn't at the graduation. I wasn't there. I wasn't this. Can I tell you that God can do anything? It's never too late for you to step up. It's never too late for you to put your foot out there. It's never too late for you to be present and to do what it is that you need to do. Oh, there are so many individuals that need this word. Oh, because there's so many things that we deal with, individual not doing, even in doubt, even being absent, the absence of a father. That's what's plaguing our society. Come on, let me just hit them real quick. The absence of a father, the divorced father, the where they moved on from the marriage and moved on from the relationship, the addicted father, the critical father. No matter what you do, no matter how well you do it, it's never good enough. The distant father. You can be distant. You can be living in the house and still be distant. You know, you can be living out and still not be present. Oh, the rejecting and the neglecting father. The unfaithful father. Because I've seen what you did to my mama. I know how you broke her heart. I know what you're doing. There's a lot of individuals that's dealing with a lot of different daddy issues. Oh, the doting father. Oh, what is this? Oh, I love the children. I love my babies, but I can't stand their mama. Come on here. And we're in the house together. I'll do anything. I'll give them the shirt off my back. I play with them. I spend time with them, but I dog her out. Oh, can I tell you that there's something that my child is seeing? The seductive father, the taken father, the narcissistic father. Oh, can I tell you that we're fighting a pandemic, y'all? Come on, we're fighting the epidemic. We got coronavirus. We got racial tension, and we got the absence of the father all on our hand. And because of this, look what David said in Psalm 44:15. He said, we cannot escape. Oh, the constant humiliation, the shame is written across our faces. I believe believe that's what the problem with so many men. We had a panel. It'll be airing Shameless Plug Pastor's Perspective tomorrow at 7 p.m. We had a panel, and one individual said, it's so much to the point to where some fathers don't reach out because they don't want to hear, "Wait, I hate you, daddy." Some fathers don't reach out because they don't want to hear, "Oh, I can't stand you. Where you been at? Now all of a sudden you want to tell me what to do." Some fathers don't want to do that. The embarrassment and the humiliation that's written across their face. "Oh, but I got a word for you, father." It doesn't matter. You take whatever your child give you. You take whatever they get small with you. You take it and you step up and you say, "You know what? I wasn't there, but I'm here right now. You know what? I didn't do what I need to do, but I'm here right now." You don't shy away from the pain. You don't shy away from the hurt. You do what you need to do. Oh, the psalmist said we can't escape the constant humiliation. There's some things I did in my life I can't get away from. There's some places in my life I wish I would have went right and I went left. There's some times I wish I would have sat down and I stood up. There's some times I ran and I should have stayed. Oh, but I can't do nothing with that. Oh, but a shame may be written on your face. Oh, but I got a good word for you right now. Oh, look what Jesus said. Jesus said in Mark 9:19, he said, "Bring your son to me." Good God, can I tell you that's what God is trying to do in your life right now? No matter how bad it is, no matter how much demons be involved, no matter how much humiliation involved, Jesus said, "Bring it to me." He said, "Bring it to me." Come on, bring your pain to me. Bring your hurt to me. Bring your abandonment to me. Bring your rejection to me. Bring your issues to me. Oh, can I tell you, it doesn't matter what's going on. You ought to take it to Jesus. Oh, can I tell you, the Lord is right there and he's willing and he's ready to help you and assist you. That's what Jesus said, that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to proclaim the liberty to the captive. Oh, come on here, somebody that's captive by their daddy issue. Somebody that's captive by your past. Somebody that's captive by your hurt. And the Lord says he's anointed you for this, so that you can come out of your captivity. And the Spirit of the Lord will set at liberty them that are bruised. Come on, y'all, to put your hands together and give God some praise. I'm getting ready to roll up out of here. I say happy Father's Day. I don't care what you're going through. I don't care what you're facing right now. But can I tell you that daddy makes a difference, because the Lord said all the things that you're going through, all the things that you've been through. Look what John said in 1 John 3:8. He said, "For this reason that the Son of God appeared, to destroy the works of the devil." Can I tell you what the devil has set up in your life? That's why God came. That's why he sent his son, that he may be able to destroy the works of the devil. I heard Isaiah say, he said he was wounded for my transgression. I heard Isaiah say he was bruised for my iniquity, that the chastisement of my peace was upon him, and by his stripes I am healed. Come on, I'm not just talking about you being healed, healed in your body, but no, I'm saying you can be healed. You can be healed in your mind. I'm telling you, you can be healed in your emotions. I said you can be healed the way you can love again. I'm telling you, you can be healed from the pain of your past. I'm telling you, you can be healed from your rejection, from your abandonment. You can be healed. Come on, y'all, to type on the screen, "I want to be healed." Does anybody want to be healed? Does anybody want to be set free? I heard Paul say, "And I want to be healed." In Philippians 3:13, he said, "Brothers, I count not myself to apprehend it." Come on, that's Pastor Kobe today. I'm not the perfect father. I'm not apprehended it. Come on, that's Pastor Kobe right there. I don't know how to raise no girls. Come on, I used to be nasty. I used to be promiscuous. I don't know how to raise no girls. I don't know how to raise no son. I'm not apprehended what I apprehended yet. But there's one thing I do. I forget those things that are behind me. Can I help y'all today? Whether you got daddy issues, whether your daddy did it to you, or maybe you the daddy. Can I tell you, you got to forget those things that are behind you. And you got to reach. You got to reach for those things that are before you. Look what Paul said. He said, "I press." Is there anybody here? Is there anybody on the YouTube? Is there anybody on Facebook? Is there anybody on Twitter that got a press in your spirit? I
know you've been dropped. I know you've been abandoned. But do you got a press in your spirit? Daddy didn't bother, mother didn't cover. But do you got a press in your spirit? I'm not what I used to be, but thank God I'm not what I was. But I got a press in my heart. I heard Pastor Kobe say that daddies make a difference. And when your earthly father, when he walk away from you, when your earthly father, when he abandon you, when you don't get the child support, when you don't get the college tuition, when he don't buy you your first car, when he done there for you to walk you down the aisle, when he won't be there for you for your first dance. I heard Paul say in Romans 8:15, he said, you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear. In other words, when you came into the family of God, you don't got to be afraid. But know what your daddy didn't do. There's a heavenly father. What your daddy didn't do, you don't got to be afraid of your heavenly father. I heard the disciples say, they say, Lord, teach us how to pray. And I heard Jesus say, he say, when you pray, say, our Father. He's my Father. He's your Father. He's our Father. And Paul said, we not receive the spirit of fear. He said, but we receive the spirit of adoption, whereby we can cry, Abba. Or maybe from Detroit, and you'll say, Abba. He said, you can cry, Abba. Abba, Father. You can cry, Daddy. Is there anybody in here that know that daddy makes a difference? What your earthly father didn't do, what your earthly daddy didn't do, there's another daddy, there's another father that he'll step up, he'll hold you, he'll rock you, he'll soothe you, he'll wipe your pain, he'll wipe your tears, he'll take away your hurt. Maybe you like me and your daddy's gone. Maybe you're like me and your daddy's in heaven. But I got a word for you. When your mother and your father forsake you, the Lord said, he said, I'll take you up. He said, I'll lift you up. He said, I'll protect you. I'll hold you. I'll give you what no man can do. I'll be there for you. You ought to give your God some praise.